So delighted to be with everyone this evening. Thanks for staying on. My name is Jim Joyce, and I'm the CEO and co-founder of a company called HealthBeacon. HealthBeacon, for those that aren't aware of us, our mission is to build smart tools for managing medications, and we're specifically focusing on the medical market. So we're a digital health tech company that has designed, what you're looking on the screen is the world's first FDA-cleared, NHSX-approved smart sharp spin that works with patients that need to inject medications in the home setting. So you can think about diabetics, rheumatoid arthritis sufferers, people with multiple sclerosis, asthma. In fact, if you were to peer into pharmaceutical pipelines, you would see that the technique of getting helping patients access really powerful, effective medications and reclaim some of their health back. The technique of using subcutaneous injection therapy for large molecule biologic medications is a really growing area. About $300 billion worth of medications will be self-administered by patients in their home setting, and we'll walk you through why that makes sense. So I'm just going to move you through our slides here. So I'm going to jump right ahead here. So when you think about HealthBeacon as an organization, we have the world's leading platform for helping patients adhere to their injectable schedules. And we'll show you how our technology works and how our system works. That's against a backdrop of about 30 million people between the US, Europe, and the UK are dependent on injectable medications as they're describing different conditions. The challenge with patients that need to self-administer injectable medications in the home setting is similar to challenges people generally face with medications for chronic and critical conditions, is that 1 in 2 patients will fail on their medications within the first 12 months of initiating. That's where, specifically for injectables, that's where HealthBeacon comes in. If you go on your injectable medications plus the HealthBeacon system and technology, you're up to 26% more likely to adhere to your medication schedule. So we help recover patients that otherwise might have missed injections or else failed in their medications altogether. So that's what we do as an organization, just to set that scene. Back in, a little bit about the organization, we're about 70 people. We're headquartered out of Dublin, Ireland. Our US operations are between Boston and Orlando. And we do extensive work in the UK, a couple of different jurisdictions. If we, as an organization, we took the company public on the EURONEXT Dublin back in December. We raised 25 million euros in order to kind of scale our business. What you'll see, hopefully, from the presentation is that our technology has been adopted by some of the largest pharmaceutical companies in the world, some of the biggest health systems, some of the biggest insurance systems, and we have about 10,000 patients. We have about 10,000 devices deployed between the U.S., Europe, and the U.K. right now. And we went public in order to scale our organization to be able to get 100,000 devices into the market by the year 2023. We had confidence that we could do that based on a couple of large deals, largely led out of the U.S. market. It will impact that and show you how that works. So, super excited to kind of walk you through what's happening with us as an organization. In the effort to go public, we've assembled what we think is a world-class board and governance structure. With people with very specific expertise in the space of digital healthcare, specialty pharmacy. We'll tell you why that makes sense, as well as government and pharmaceutical area. So we've got a fantastic board that helped us get the company across the line. And just for those that, as I'm walking through, just to explain our technology a little bit more detail, basically what happens with patients is that any patient that goes on subcutaneous injection therapy is required to have something called a sharp spin, simple little plastic bin that goes into their home setting. Our innovation is we've taken this practical, useful household item and we've turned that into a patient engagement tool called a smart sharp spin. The smart sharp spin knows, basically goes into the patient's home and it knows the prescription schedule of the patient, lets the patient know when it's time to take their medication by kind of alerting and lighting, a little text or companion app, lets them know it's time to take their medication, tells them where in their body they need to inject. And then the act of dropping a used syringe or needle top into our smart sharp spin, we use image recognition and we recognize that you just took your medication, what type of medication and when you took that. And then that starts our kind of care management system. So we know which patients are struggling to take the medication, and then we digitally interact with them if they are struggling, and we take their data and we bring it back into their clinicians in an anonymized way. We take that data and bring that back into our clients like insurance companies and pharmaceutical companies. So that's our kind of smart sharp spin technology. As I mentioned before, if you go on our technology, you're 26% more likely to adhere to your medication per our peer-reviewed research. Beyond our kind of device that goes into the patient's home, we have a powerful set of dashboard and analytical tools that go into clinical offices, that go back into insurance companies that really help us unlock the data. And then specifically, we have a system that as their patients dispose of their use, single-use, you know, plastic injectable medications into our device, we have a system that allows us to help reclaim their medications and bring that back into a HealthBeacon facility where we more sustainably process their medications and help them get rid of that in a practical way. And then we have a companion app that goes into the hands of the patient. So if I did anything else, I explained at least how the technology works. Just to kind of give you a little bit of sense of our business model and how we work. So we really do, you know, four things for patients: real-time prescription monitoring, safe and sustainable disposal. We engage with the patients and educate them on their condition. And then we have these analytical tools that go into clinicians and insurance systems and health systems. We charge on average 25 euros per patient per month. And we have a multi-distribution strategy. So the first area that we're the most developed in is that we integrate our technology into existing patient services programs with large pharmaceutical companies, and in the US with what's called large specialty pharmacy organizations. They pay for the device, you know, as a result of the increased adherence that we achieve and the effect that we have and the support that we're providing. The large pharma company and patient support programs pay for our device, and then we supply the device directly to the patient free of charge. That's our first distribution model. Our second distribution model, we just recently launched. We signed a large deal with a company called Hamilton Beach in the US, who is the largest supplier of small household appliances in the US. They're in 89% of all US households, a small compliance supplier. And we signed a deal with them where we've taken our product and we've made that available in a direct-to-consumer way, you know, initially through our dedicated website and their distribution channels. And then we'll be moving that into retail pharmacy and other .com assets throughout the course of the year. So that's kind of launching right now. So we have our patient services model, we have a direct-to-consumer model, and then we have an insurance model where we've gone to some of the largest insurance companies in the world, and we've got our technology directly reimbursed as a result of the kind of cost savings that we can supply into the system by having a more adherent patient that costs, you know, that drives down the cost of healthcare down the line. As I mentioned before, we had a 10,000 devices deployed and with our customers and in patients' homes at the end of 2021. And through our different distribution models and our client base, we have a clear path of getting ourselves to 100,000 units by the end of 2023. So that's just a little bit about our business model and how we work. Just to kind of unpack that a little bit more, give you a sense with this, we work with, some of the companies that I can name, Sanofi, Novartis, Teva, large specialty pharmacy organizations in the US. That's who backs our patient support programs. Really what we've done for those organizations, if we've kind of taken our technology to them, you know, we've asked, hey, can we add our program to your existing patient support structure? We'll drive, you know, higher adherence rates, and we'll drive down the cost of supporting these patients and ultimately the cost of care. So that's been a super successful model and application for us. We most recently signed a major deal with one of the top five specialty pharmacy organizations in the US that have given us really clear line of sight, for growth in the business. We anticipate getting about 15,000 units from that one contract alone by the end of 2022, in multiples of that into 2023. The second deal I probably have covered, so in the interest of time, I'll keep moving on, but we have a really exciting direct-to-consumer partner that we're now actively turning on an advertising campaign and bringing our product into the U.S. consumer. Just to get a sense of the U.S. market for us, There's about 9 million patients on subcutaneous injection therapy in the US, about 6 million diabetics. And there's culturally a real aptitude towards paying for aspects of healthcare. So we've created a really compelling offering helping these patients. These patients aren't well supported in the US from our perspective right now in terms of how they are supported around adherence and how they're supported around the practical act of disposing of their injections after taking them from their home setting. Our total addressable market, when we think about that, I'll probably just jump right to it. We have about, as I mentioned probably early on, we have over $300 billion worth of medications that are administered, by patients in the home setting. When we think about our addressable market, we get there by taking 25 euros or 30 US dollars per month is what we charge for our product. And there's about 30 million patients between US, Europe, and the UK. And that's how we get to a $10 billion addressable market. Really, the statement there is we're playing in a really, really big market. It might seem like a niche market, but it's an area that needs a lot of support. And we see long-term continued growth for us. Being kind of first to market with a technology like this, we spent a lot of time investing in IP, integrating our technology, connecting it into the ecosystem, satisfying all of the different regulatory and data burdens. And we've also been able to track over 600,000 injections, giving us a proprietary database. Probably the last part of our kind of moating strategy that we've invested in extensively is just doing a really good job implementing our technology with these large pharmaceutical companies and insurance companies. So we've become a trusted healthcare partner to a lot of our organizations. So we think with that and the fact that our technology might seem simple, but bringing an IoT device with a complex regulated space gives us a good headway. And we anticipate kind of being on the market as kind of the leading company in the space, certainly for the near future, and allowing us to kind of invest in our own technology and get ourselves this 10x growth that we're anticipating. Our supply chain, a lot of people ask questions about our own supply chain. We make our plastics are made in China. They're shipped into the Irish market through our contract manufacturer. We do assembly. Then the units go into our own production facility where we do a final kind of SIM connectivity and quality control check. And then we ship directly to our customers. We've taken proceeds from the IPO in order to secure long lead times parts for us. And allow us to kind of stabilize our supply chain. When we think about the $25 million that we raised in the IPO, about $12 million of that is just going towards building, the inventory that we require in order to get ourselves to that 100,000 units. About $10 million is just building out that teams, and the rest is in kind of software development. So we while we're operating in a difficult environment from a supply chain perspective, we feel good about being able to, deliver against our forecasts. It's been an incredibly exciting time for us as an organization. We really did the IPO on the back of a couple of exciting deals with a long tail of a pipeline of big pharmaceutical companies that we've been working for. We've been able to deliver against that promise of getting those deals signed and getting them launched out the door. We've delivered on some of our claims in order to be able to study our products. So we published some really exciting peer-reviewed research around the effect that we have with patients. And we signed on lots of new clients. So we feel pretty excited. We just had our first kind of inaugural earnings announcements that we went through, with our 2021 results. And we had committed kind of coming out of that we would we would kind of almost double our revenue. So we had about 84% growth in our top line and our revenue line. We wanted to more than double our unit deployments. We were able to do that. We have a gross profit margin that we can maintain over the lifetime of our product of over 60%. So we're at about 65%. We have a good cash position of about 26 million euros, and we're feeling really good about what the future has ahead of us. Our outlook, if I were to kind of bring it back right now, is we have this incredibly exciting, validated solution that's solving a real big problem in healthcare, and that's people. We have great medications, but if the patients don't take the medications, they're not going to help the patients from a health perspective. They're not going to help the economies from in terms of managing costs, there's a real opportunity to help these patients. And there hasn't been systems that can really target them in a meaningful way. We've got, just an absolutely exciting client base. And we have a really clear pathway to growing this business and, you know, commanding long-term leadership in the space, you know, and exciting prospects from there. So, you know, we're an organization with 10,000 units, and we're looking to get 100,000 units by the end of 2023. And, you know, enjoying the rigs and reels of being a publicly traded company. But I think probably like the last presenter, I think one of the most critical things that's happened to us as a public company is we've gotten the resources we need to really grow and scale this company to make it one of the iconic digital healthcare companies going forward in the future. So I think, I don't know if I've gone too quickly here, but I think I'm done with my presentations and happy to open it up to Q&A.
James, you've got perfect modulation. It's a perfect speed. Don't worry. And congratulations on delivering against your forecasts, because supply chain issues have been the bugbear of many companies that I've hosted over the past few years, but not you. However, it has come at a cost. So you've spent nearly half of, in fact, maybe more than half of your IPO funds on getting that inventory at a level that you're comfortable with, on that pathway to the 100,000 in 2023. So how comfortable are you with the amount that you've spent on inventory and securing that supply chain?
Yeah, so I mean, I think I'm clear. We, you know, we're projected to spend of the 25 million over the next, you know, over the next, you know, year and a half. We'll have spent that 12 million on the supply chain, you know, kind of net figure. So what we did is we took some of those proceeds and locked in the kind of long lead time parts. So the investment that we've kind of expended is more in the long lead time parts that we needed to do. So I think in the answering the question on the supply chain side, it's not an easy environment to operate in terms of moving physical product around the world. We face a lot of the constraints that other organizations face. We have an excellent team. You know, my co-founder in this company is a real expert in manufacturing and procurement from a technical perspective. We build a nice team. So it's an area that we just have to manage really, really tightly and just be on top of every day. We managed to get a 7,000 unit build done between the end of Q4 and into Q1. So in this climate, we've been able to kind of build and keep our production moving, but we're also looking forward to kind of a release of the supply chain, hopefully in 2023.
Sure, it's a great product as well. Trevor Phillips says, how easy would it be for another company to replicate? What protection do you have against this? Now, in my research, I can see you've got 30 design and utility patents. Only 30. I'm wondering, is it enough? Do you have enough protection?
Yeah. So, I mean, I think I kind of often answer the question, if you, I'm the inventor on the product, and if you were to ask me to go rebuild this product in the morning, and you were to give me 25 or 30 million euros, you know, I would be a couple years before I had what we have today. So, you know, while it looks simple, you know, from its manifestation, and we've done that purposely, our product kind of seamlessly integrates into a patient's life. So we want it to be simple and elegant, but there's incredible amounts of complexity of getting FDA clearance, NHSX approval, integrated in with health systems, an IoT device, something communicating, you know, through all its different channels. So you just, you know, between IoT, software development, being in a regulated sector, you have to invest in that platform. So not simple is the short answer. We have good IP coverage around it. So you certainly would face us if you went in and tried to kind of knock it off. But then the biggest thing is, you know, you become a trusted supplier. These big pharma companies, these big health systems aren't risk-seeking if they have a good supplier and they're working with you and we've integrated in there. So I think that's one of our best kind of moating strategy is just do a really good job with our clients. They're not going to switch us out of patients' homes or out of their kind of, you know, step away. And they certainly couldn't do it quickly.
So you just said there, you are the inventor. I think you're a 10% shareholder as well. But I'm just wondering, what was the reason for you becoming the inventor of this product? Trevor Phillips is asking, what are the reasons for up to 1 in 2 patients failing to take their medication? So if you can answer that, sure, and explain how you got involved in this.
Yeah, 100%. Yeah. So I, you know, my own background was in the pharmaceutical industry. So I had launched lots of medications like what we're talking about, these subcutaneous injection therapy, these ones in critical areas. I went on to build my first company in the health services space where I had teams of nurses training patients in supporting these types of chronic disease sufferers. So we knew the challenges that these patients faced, right? So the so probably to answer Trevor's question in first is that there's when we think about one in two patients failing, about 20 to 30% of the reason for people not failing is actually because the drug doesn't work. So there's a group of people that fail, but the majority of reasons for people fail is what I describe as non-clinical, the right habit, forgetting, you know, fear out of injecting, you know, managing through side effects that could be manageable, administrative challenges in the US, it might be a copay, it might be something practical around delivery or access to it, belief in the drug. So there's a range of reasons that lead up to that kind of, you know, those failures. It's not one size fits all. What's key with our system is that we can find out when they're failing, contextually know exactly when it's happening, and then try to find out the reason and try to help them if it's something that otherwise, if they're failing because the drug not working, then they should be pulled off the drug and put on the drug. Hopefully that would work for them.
So when I saw, sorry, I've interrupted, carry on.
No, just on the inventor side. So I mean, like so like a lot of these things is like a you know, 20-year overnight success for me in terms of inventing it. I see this problem. I support family members that are on injectable medications. I have been working in the space for a long time, and I really saw that the, you know, patients struggle with these medications, and the idea that we could take something they're all required to have, they all have to have the sharp spins, and we can make that more useful, more valuable, and kind of earn a place in the home. And the critical thing about adherence is you can't get at the data, you know, so, you know, how do you kind of, you know, passively monitor that? So this idea really came up as a result of work I was doing in my last area. And I became obsessed with this idea that if I can go into that sharp spin, I can see that active disposal, I tested it, I can see if they've taken their medications when they're supposed to. And that's really was kind of the genesis for it.
I like the way that you use that word, that you're obsessed with it. I'm just wondering, are you as persistent as you want your customers to become in terms of managing their medication, as it were?
I think with our customers, you know, with these big organizations, they recognize we don't have to sell on the problem. If you're a healthcare system, an insurance company, a pharmaceutical company, you understand, you can see directly that you're losing either clinical effect or revenue, or it's costing you more money. Adherence is a well-documented issue. So we don't have to convince them adherence is a problem. So they're looking for solutions. I think some of the challenge you'll see with these organizations, it takes them a while to adopt new technology. Once you're in and have adopted new technology, they stay with you. You know, that's the history here. So the kind of onboarding time you'll see takes a little time for these companies to come on, but once you're in the system, they will persist.
So I went onto your website and I went, wow, I have never seen such a diverse group of people. It is absolutely astonishing. So I'm going to be cheeky and ask, is this collection, this curation of amazing people by design?
Well, 100%. I mean, I describe myself as instead of, you know, you have this term Irish American, and I'm kind of American Irish. So I moved to Ireland from America. My wife is Italian. Our kids all have different accents. They have 100 accents. I think we, like a lot of us, I think we value diversity, right? We value diversity of opinion. I didn't want to build an organization that didn't have that perspective. When we look, say, on the gender diversity issue, you know, 75% of autoimmune sufferers are female. And actually tend to skew a bit younger. So, you know, this idea that, you know, it's only older people that need help. We need people with international perspective. So 100% by design, you know, I probably, like yourself, I love working with different diverse people with diverse opinions. So why not embrace it?
So you're going at full pelt. So I'm just wondering, sort of circling back to one of the first questions I ask about cash burn. Is it all manageable? Are you making enough money? I know that you're, you know, 100,000 devices in the market by 2023. That's a nice round number. It's not a big number, though, and you're actually not charging your customers an awful lot. So is that going to be a problem in the future? You're going to have to raise prices?
Well, no, when we look at our, you know, if you do the kind of simple math, in some ways, our model, we have a reoccurring revenue model. That 100,000 devices gets us to about, you know, a run rate of about $30 million, you know, US dollars. If you take, $30 per patient per month times 100,000 devices, you know, that's where you kind of end up. With that numbers, you know, we start to move into profitability. So we've moved into profitability in 2023. So, you know, we've got good gross margins on the product. And also, while it might not seem like a lot from a scale of a digital health technology company, obviously we don't stop at 100,000. Our ambition isn't to be a 100,000 unit company. We have innovations that we see in behind this that allow us to expand the addressable market. But once we're on that kind of growth clip, you know, we're going to grow right past 100,000 is our game plan.
So does this Irish-American, American-Irish founder, inventor have any aspirations to list on a different stock exchange? You are listed on the Euronext Growth Market, which has fantastic credentials, but you now have FDA accreditation and credentials. So I'm wondering if the next obvious move to help this growth is to list on an alternative or an additional stock market.
Well, I think, sir. I mean, we're so new in our listing right now, you know, and it was quite a bit of work to get that done, you know, from that perspective. So we, you know, I think we, you know, in some ways, we're looking at this right now. We're definitely keeping all options open for ourselves in terms of, you know, future raising capital, you know, thinking about liquidity in the market, you know, but we're kind of at the moment we're dead focused on building this business, you know, getting ourselves 100,000 units, and that 25 million gets us on the path. But we're definitely open to it. We're just not, you know, we're probably just still digesting the first listing, I suppose.
Sure. I'm just wondering if this is the first of a suite of products. You're an inventor. You'll never stop being an inventor. It's part of your DNA. So you've got proof of concept with this product that we're looking at here. But are there others in the pipeline?
You're right. You're right. We definitely, you know, we obviously, if you're inventing something like this, you're believing in it. I think it's a compromise. You know, it's this kind of, when we think about this, we have a really important role to play. We're the only ones that are tackling injectable kind of challenges for these patients in this way. So we want to be true to delivering against that promise and not getting too distracted. But there's some natural extensions that we move in to help. Things like, for example, just integrating a simple connected weight scale or your Alexa, you know, some obvious integrations that we can do that allows people to talk to their health beacon, that allows us to track outcomes, you know, for diabetics or obesity patients or people on growth hormones that are delivered by injections. So there's some natural, easy innovations that we can look into that we're certainly contemplating. And then to your point, you know, we want to be a big iconic company. So we definitely have stuff in our pipeline. We just haven't, we haven't announced that. We want to make sure as an organization, we kind of win this first battle of leadership in injectables.
So my final question is about inclusion. You talked about Alexa there. Of course, we are in the era, a new economy of digitization. There are, of course, members of the community who are not tech savvy. They don't know who Alexa is. They have a need for what you've created, but they might not have access to the internet or broadband. So what is the solution for them?
Well, I think, you know, starting off with it, when we implemented our first technology, we describe it as you could accidentally implement this technology correctly. So we actually brought the technology out without a companion app. You could just replace your simple smart sharp, you know, traditional sharp spin with our smart one, and it would work. We know your prescription schedule. So all that technology is kind of behind the scenes. You just dropped your use injection into it, and then we're monitoring. So I agree with you. A lot of people, you know, don't want to fiddle with Wi-Fi or download complicated apps or, you know, have all kinds of configuration issues. So we approach it very much with that lens. Broadband. We use cellular connectivity, so you don't need broadband to get into it. Again, purposely, no configuration required. You take your device in the home. So we started off with that as a principle that we're likely to be working with people, you know, that might not have access to broadband or want that hassle or complexity associated with it. And then we kind of introduced the companion app, you know, to our technology after we've got the device in your home as a repository of your data. but you don't need that companion app to work on the device.
I'm so glad I asked that, because there you go. You've highlighted the simplicity of your device. However, you've kind of convinced us that what you've created might be simple, but it is not easily, if at all, reproducible by anybody else, such as a competitor or a, I don't know, a nasty fake criminal. So that is very good. James Joyce, co-founder and chief executive of HealthBeacon, thank you very much indeed. We look forward to finding out if you hit that 100,000 device benchmark by 2023 and then what next is in the pipeline. Thank you very much indeed.
Thanks so much. A pleasure to be with you.